Welcome. I'm Peter Plochen and I work as Risk Management Specialist within SAS. In the next few minutes, I would like to show you how SAS Model Risk Management can help your financial institution to deal with the current and even more importantly, with the upcoming challenges in the model governance and model risk management space. Let's get started. When we look at what is currently happening in the banking industry, we can clearly see that the banks are being challenged on multiple fronts simultaneously. First, there's an increasing demand for more model governance and model risk awareness. And this is coming from both the business side, pushing for higher utilization of models in banks' decision taking, but also from the regulatory side, where the recent guidelines put banks under unprecedented scrutiny. At the same time, the banks are pushed to faster model deployment and model performance. And lastly, in parallel, the banks are required to build new models, with a very good example being the IFRS 9 impairments. According to some senior model risk managers, IFRS 9 will have significant impact on banks' MRM processes. Let's explore a bit this impact that IFRS 9 will have on banks' MRM processes. Compared to the current impairment regime, IFRS 9 will have more financial impact, will require more impairments, and these will have to be recalculated more often to capture the changes in the credit quality. The impairments calculation will be more complex and will require collection of more data and development of more models. IFRS 9 principles offer more alternative interpretation that will define the methodology behind these new models. All this work will require much more internal cooperation between risk and finance, and everything will have to be accepted by the statutory auditor. Therefore, robust governance around all these new data, models, interactions, and calculations will be crucial. To conclude, impact of IFRS 9 should not be underestimated when thinking about the future of banks' model risk management and model governance processes. But IFRS 9 is just one piece of a puzzle in all these developments. At SAS, we designed our model risk management solution that it can address not only the current challenges that your bank is facing now, but also the ones that are for sure yet to come. So what is it actually? In a nutshell, you can think of our solution as a robust model information system that tracks all the relevant information and stakeholder involvement across the whole end-to-end modeling lifecycle. It allows to establish linkages between relevant components of the modeling universe, for example, between model feeding another model, or between a model and their usages. All interactions between various stakeholders and approval cycle follow the underlying workflow that define which information has to be provided or which action has to be taken by whom and when. Once all this information is collected and stored in a secured fashion, various reports can be easily built using the intuitive self-service reporting engine. All the reports, workflows, and screens or data definitions are fully configurable by the business user without the need for IT involvement or any hard code coding. To get you started quickly, we provide out-of-the-box content based on the industry best practices, which you can start using, learn what works for your organization and what not, and evolve it as you go ahead so it best fits your need. By having such information system in place, you can quickly identify areas with concentration of model risk and focus your attention there. By following predefined workflows, you can streamline the processes, reduce manual handovers, but also achieve efficiencies by sharing information among the relevant stakeholders. And last but not least, be ready for any questions about your models that might come from external or internal stakeholders. Let me show you now how this can look in reality. Now, let's assume that I am a model governance officer who wants to manage and monitor model risk. First, I need to know where does the model risk reside in my organization and what is driving it. For this purpose, I can use our model risk dashboard. This dashboard uses an example model risk quantification framework where we score every model on their importance, or materiality in other words, and quality, or criticality. By combining these two scores, we can plot each model on a model risk matrix, which allows me to quickly spot not only the models that are most important for our organization, in other words, having the highest materiality, but also the ones that require our immediate attention, having the highest criticality. For example, I can see here that I have 39 models that have both highest materiality and highest criticality scores. This is where I need to focus. Furthermore, by aggregating these two scores, first on individual model level and then across relevant model sub-portfolios, allows me to monitor model risk concentrations. For example, I can clearly see that my derivatives models portfolio requires immediate attention. I can easily zoom into a particular business unit and explore the model risk concentration there. Here, I see that within my Sunshine Financial business unit, it is the inflation model portfolio that requires our attention. Besides the model risk quantification information, there is much more other useful information tracked in our system, which is available to support the bank's governance processes. Let's assume now that I am the manager of the model validation team who wants to plan model validations for the next half of a year. In order to do that, I want to get an idea of how many models are being developed at the moment, because these will need to get validated by my team. For this, I will move now to the model governance overview section of our dashboard. In this overview, I can see distribution of all models into stages of their lifecycle. I can also see the number of registered findings from previous validations. And what could concern me here is the unusually high number of pending findings, which have not yet been accepted by the owners. But for now, I want to focus on the new models that are going to be developed. I see there are 34 such models. Let's say that I am in particular interested in scorecard models because they require most effort to get validated. And I see that there are 18 of them. I want to get a better idea of what kind of models these are, and therefore I zoom into our model inventory. In this section, I can now see the selected scorecard models alongside with some key information, such as model risk score that we discussed earlier. I see that this one model has 20 submodels associated with it, but it's still marked as low risk. Let's say, for example, that I believe that such model with that many linked submodels should get a higher criticality rating. To do this, I will first zoom into the model details section, where I can see more information about this particular model, like associated findings, action plans, etc. Here, by clicking on the model, I jump into the operational environment where the model information is managed. Now, we will have a quick look at the environment where we can view, review, edit the information about our selected models, depending on our rights and the stage of the model lifecycle. Here, we can see that our selected model is currently in the created stage. We can see the description of the type of the model and of the model itself, and also the key stakeholders linked with this model. Lastly, we can also see the rating information, which I will now change to major. This environment allows us to store and track various information about our model, such as linked models with various levels of relationship. Here we can see the 20 submodels. We can also link our model with other objects, like findings and model reviews, but also store model documentation or model performance reports. Depending on my role and stage of the lifecycle, the underlying workflow defines my available actions, and I will receive notifications when I am expected to perform a particular task. I can see any time where I am within the workflow. At this point, my options are either to send the model form to model risk management team or to the model owner. All what we have seen here, workflows, reports, page definitions, and metadata definitions, is fully configurable by a business user without the need to do any coding. To get you started, we provide you with out-of-the-box content based on the industry best practices, which you can adapt to your needs along the way. So this was a quick overview of our model risk management solution, where I showed you how we can help your institution not only to decrease the model risk, but also reduce the workload and increase efficiencies and awareness. And lastly, but not least, comply with regulations. For more information, please visit our model risk management webpage. In case you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact me. I would like to thank you for your time today and have a great day.